each of our hearts is a pilgrim heart. Each one wants to know the reason why the wind dies and where the stories go. Pilgrims, on your journeys, you may travel far, for it is a long way to find out who you are. In our hearts, we are always wondering which way will lead us to the deeper truth of who we are. We're always on a journey together and alone, finding, falling out of, and rediscovering our own rhythm. We, pilgrims, this past summer, each had our own reasons for walking the Camino de Santiago in Spain. Some of us just wanted to travel. Others felt called long before Anitra offered us the opportunity here at All Souls. Several of us were being intentional with the big transitions in our lives, a recent death of a loved one, the awareness of an approaching big birthday with its reminder that our time here on Earth is short. There were 20 of us, all told. We are religious and irreligious, Catholic and not, from All Souls and not. Some of us trained physically and prepared ourselves mentally and spiritually, and some of us just showed up hoping for the best. They say your Camino starts when you decide to take the journey. I think we would all agree that the Camino never really ends. It's living on in us, working on us long after we put away our hiking shoes, our walking sticks, our water bottles, and our backpacks. Setting out as a pilgrim is an ancient spiritual practice. People set out on pilgrimages in ancient Egypt, Greece, and Rome. People in India, China, Japan, and throughout the Muslim world go on pilgrimage. The ancient Hebrews and all kinds of Christians go on pilgrimages, and today, one doesn't even have to be religious to go on pilgrimage. In 2016, fewer than half of the pilgrims arriving in Santiago said they were traveling for religious purposes. About half said they were traveling for spiritual or cultural reasons. 8% said other. That fits our group pretty well. We walked an ancient way through little villages, tiny villages, medium-sized towns, and large cities in Galicia, a hilly, damp, green region in northwest Spain. There were yellow arrows of all sizes marking the way, like trail markers. And sometimes there were signs next to the yellow arrows telling us how many more kilometers we had left to walk. We walked on paved roads, rock-lined streets, hard-packed dirt, slippery mud, and every combination thereof you can think of. We walked with each other. We walked with strangers who became friends. We walked alone and discovered we never truly are alone. At the beginning, we were each invited to carry a rock that represented something we wanted to let go of. And we were invited to leave that rock somewhere along the way. When we couldn't walk because of fatigue or a sore limb or a very sore toe or an injury, we let go of that. We accepted even that. We laid down even that hope that we would walk the whole way. We left a lot behind. One thing we brought back is stories. We are all pilgrims, really, in our hearts wondering which of these is true, the road that leads to nowhere or the road that leads to you.
I don't believe in magic. I love magic, but I don't believe in magic. Or signs from heaven, or ghosts, or miracles, or God, really, in any traditional sense. So it was strange to find within myself an intense desire to go on a Catholic pilgrimage. As I prepared for the trip, I came to realize that I was looking for a way to heal some old religious scars, to connect with religion in a non-threatening way. And Roman Catholicism felt a safe enough distance from evangelical Protestantism. And to release decades-old anger and guilt and shame. Shame. That's the big bad. I debuted the idea of trying to be a worthy sanctuary for my parents' God many years ago, but I hadn't shaken the idea of trying to be worthy in general, of being fundamentally unworthy. So, on our very first day hiking out of Osobrero, I picked up the ugliest, most pitted, jagged little rock I could find. And as I squeezed it in my palm, I imagined imbuing it with all of the shame and insecurity and irrational guilt that were the unintentional relics of my upbringing. Then I put it in the little zipper pocket of my backpack. And I carried that rock through breathtaking mountain vistas and fields of wildflowers as far as I could see. I carried it as I walked for hours in silence. And as I walked for hours in conversation with strangers from all over the world, I carried it as I got desperately lost and then found again. I carried it into the little shop of a masseur who read my fortune according to which polished stone I pulled out of a bowl. It was jade, by the way, and foretold happiness. As I carried it, as over the miles and days, I began to love and trust my companions enough to open some of those deeply buried internal doors and share some of what was hidden inside. I carried it into churches where I felt just humbled by the centuries of history and community housed there, rather than merely judged as I had so often before. And when one day a dear friend and fellow pilgrim gave me a tiny cross, I cherished it as a token of genuine affection that I know it was meant to be, rather than some course of attempt to proselytize. And I put that little treasure into the pocket with my rock. As we made the final trek into Santiago, I did feel a lightness in my heart, a peace both with religion and with myself. I reached into my pocket to retrieve my ugly rock, ready to lay it and all of my ugliness down at the feet of Santiago. But it was gone. It had been there for 100 miles. But on that day, the day, it was gone. Rather than the rough sandy edges of the rock, my fingers brushed the smooth, cold polish of jade. My first thoughts were practical. How could this happen? I hadn't even opened that pocket for days. Then a terrible revelation began to wash over me. I stopped short in the middle of the path, causing a disturbance in the flow of pilgrims around me. Time dilated as I pulled that shiny jade of happiness out of my pocket. And in that moment, I knew. I don't get to lay down the parts of myself that I don't like, the inconvenient parts, the less than perfect parts. If I want to move forward to love myself and find peace within myself, I'm required to lay down this shiny, happy mask. The part of me that tells those who truly care about me that everything's fine when it's not fine. The part of me that pre-screens every word and second guesses every action to make sure that they're right. I'm going to have to learn to love all of those rough edges. And worse, I'm going to have to allow others to see them and to love them too. Whew. A terrifying notion. Terrifying notion, really. But I left that jade in Santiago and brought home with me the intention of living with authenticity. Now, I never did find the ugly rock, and I don't have any explanation for its disappearance. I don't think the stones were switched by magic. They weren't a sign from the universe or God's hand reaching down to guide me. But I do believe that if your mind is open and if your heart is willing, a well-timed coincidence can become a life-changing lesson.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth. Well, when I heard about the Camino, I also said, I've got to do that. I want to do that. That was quite a few years ago, and it just came about. And there we were in this ancient village. We went to Mass. We were blessed in five languages, and we were given our little rock. Now, before this, I had thought about this, having been raised Catholic. I knew that a pilgrimage was a kind of a serious thing. And so I thought about what it would mean for me. And I knew, and everybody that knew me knew, that I had a lot of resentment and anger towards the Catholic Church. Not my wonderful high school that I went to, but just something that repelled me, and I was angry about it. So that was my intention, to get rid of this anger that I was holding in my body and my mind. So as I packed, I put that in there. Well, we started off that day in the rain, and it was wonderful. And we walked and we walked and we walked, and it was silent and it was filled with birds. And after a while, I was kind of bored, you know, with all this beauty and everything. So I started thinking about praying and talking to God. I mean, you know, I do that a lot. And so I started saying the rosary. And I had to kind of remember what it was about. I mean, it was there inside of me. And I started praying the rosary and contemplating these events in Christ's life. And I was thinking about the one that said the birth of Christ, the birth of Jesus. And I was walking along, trudging along, and I was seeing this vision of, you know, Mary on the donkey with the great big belly just about to burst, and Joseph in his desperation saying, help, you know, we need a place. And the innkeeper says, well, go in the back. There's a barn back there. There's something, you know, but go back there. So they go back there, and here's the manger. Well, just as I was having that vision, that those thoughts in my mind, I looked up, and here was this manger in this little farm that we were passing through. And I go, oh, how sweet, how wonderful, you know, thank you. And I kept walking and kept saying the rosary, and the days went by, and the rain stopped, and the sun came out, and we got to Santiago, which was a big thrill, you know. We were walking fast that day to be sure we'd get to the Mass on time. We walk into this gigantic church. Just, I think thousands of us were in there. And all the gold and all the ceremony and all of the priests in their robes, and it was just whoa, you know. And I'm sitting there, I actually had a little seat, and I go, no, I don't want to be here, this isn't it. So I got up and left. A couple hours later, I went back into this gigantic church, and I was just wandering around, and I found the chapel of adoration. It was just a small place, and there were a handful of people on their knees, and in the gold cross there was the consecrated host, and I looked up, I knelt, and my heart started just pounding, just boom, 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 boom. It was scary. So I got up and I left. Then we finished our going out to the ends of the earth there on the Spanish coast. And my friend and I, we flew to Barcelona and we got a little hotel. And right across the street was a little big church. And it said that there was a daily mass every day at 8:30, and so I went. And here was this little group of devotees, you know, in the church. I went to communion. After mass, this lady up in the front, she stood up, and she got her pocketbook and her cane, and she walked down the aisle. And as she passed, we looked at each other and we smiled and just, you know, just had that moment of love between us. The next day I went to Mass again and went to communion again. And here she was again. She had her pocketbook and her cane and she walked past. We looked at each other. We put our arms out to each other and we hugged each other. We kissed each other's cheek. And all that anger was gone. All of it was gone. It was so sweet. And I know those little people, those little wonderful people are praying right now all over the world, you know, holding all of the world in their hearts. And that's our gift. So I'm going to reread the reading because it just seems like whoever Nancy Wood who wrote this just kind of knew that it was going to fit our Camino. Earth, cure me. Earth, receive my woe. Rock, strengthen me. Rock, receive my weakness. Rain, wash my sadness away. Rain, receive my doubt. Sun, make sweet my song. Sun, receive the anger from my heart. Thank you.
Morning. I knew that one day I would walk the way. I'd seen a movie called The Way, and I felt called to be a part of the subtle and magical transformations that I saw on that movie. I went this last summer, and it really couldn't have come at a better time for me. I really felt my life was in pieces, and I was in desperate need of a healing and transformative experience. I was hoping that the 18 days I was there would provide me all the answers that I needed. I'd heard of Camino magic, where the Camino provides what you need. But it felt like a lot of pressure. You know, realistically, I knew the resolutions I was seeking were not likely to be handed to me by the Camino. I needed to let go of that expectation. And I did. Before we went in a little pilgrim's blessing ceremony, I decided that I would let go of the expectations I had, even though it was difficult. It was Rumi, the Islamic scholar, who said, "The wound is where the light enters you." I just needed my wounded heart to be open enough to receive it. But that was a common theme. All of us had to deal with letting go of things. Things like the pride or fear of not being able to walk the entire way, or anger and frustration for those who suffered an injury that took them out. I had a fantasy of frolicking down a sunny road in a sleeveless tank and chacos. I also seriously wanted to have a picnic on the roadside with wine and cheese. I even carried a bottle of wine in my backpack on several occasions just in case that might happen. The realities of our trip included freezing cold rain, aching feet, knees, calves, backs, blisters, lots of blisters, downpours that seemed to not only dampen our entire bodies, but many of our spirits as well. It seemed that every day started with an uphill climb and a battle between body and mind over the likelihood of being able to finish the walk that day, or even the desire to get up and get started. And many of the meals were just borderline awful. I'm just being honest. But I was there. I was in Spain, walking the Camino de Santiago. It was very hard. I participated in some of the recommended spiritual practices, even though this was not what I was going for, but I was being open. The practices felt foreign at first, and I felt self-conscious because I didn't know what I was doing. But each step I took brought me more reassurance that there is no right way to do things. Even walking is different for everyone. And we are all on our own journeys. So I chose to spend the mornings in silence doing a loving kindness meditation. One day when I was walking with Anitra, she taught me this. She said, "Start with yourself. May I find peace. May I be safe. May I be healthy and strong. May I be happy. Do this until you feel ready to include others," she said. "Start with those closest to you." So I was thinking of Christian, Caitlin, and Cassius. Then, she said, "begin opening the circle wider, maybe even to strangers and people who are difficult to love." And after a while, this became my practice anytime I walked alone, not just the mornings. I was all, "Thank you, feet, for getting me this far. Good job, Carla." And then, "Love and peace and prosperity to you, love and peace and prosperity to you." I felt like a fairy godmother just throwing out goodwill and wishes and love, like it was a gift that I had an endless supply to give. And I learned I have an endless supply of love to give. Even in the difficulties and struggles, there was still beauty. The breathtaking vistas, the cowbells heard more than a mile away, the mist through the green trees, the occasional ray of sunshine that broke through, a cafe con leche, a red flower in a sea of yellow, the deep and beautiful conversations with my new friends, and the laughs we shared over cold days and bad food. The bikers zooming past yelling, "Buen camino," as they race down the street. As the days passed, the proverbial and literal clouds parted, and we finished our journey and arrived in Santiago. I didn't really leave Spain with a sense of being transformed, but I was. I didn't have any epiphanies about how to deal with life, but I did feel like I knew how to deepen relationships. If you take a walk with somebody, it'll happen. I still had to figure out how to manage my hectic schedule when I came home, but I remembered it's okay to let go of things. I still have periods of sadness and regret, but I also remember to thank my feet for bringing me here and my heart for the courage to love and forgive. I never frolicked, unless you count the trip to see a castle, but in the end, that was more sledging than frolicking. And I did eventually get to have a sort of picnic on the roadside, and I shared some wine with Barbara as we ate our mediocre leftovers one day. I learned to let go in how to love again, loving myself and others with an endless supply. And in these ways, I experienced transformation, subtle and gentle transformations happening with each step on the Camino and in life. Maybe I experienced Camino magic after all. Thank you.
Lao Tzu describes the Tao, the reality that underlies all reality, as being summed up in these two words. Walk on. Walk on. The definition of a pilgrim is someone who is walking to a place with a special significance. So I say to you this morning that it's up to you, pilgrims, to choose what the intention of your journey is, to pay attention to the signs and the helpers along the way, to let go of expectations, and to let yourself get lost. In your heart of hearts, where is the yellow arrow pointing? What is your intention? Is it to love and be loved, no matter what? Is it to let go of your resentments, to forgive, and let yourself be forgiven? To protect and serve life, to accept yourself as you are? Is it to create or simply to appreciate beauty? What is your intention? Our first night on the Camino was the first time all 20 of us were together. We were in the little village of Osobrero, which was shrouded in fog and mist that evening, making the thatched roof, 100-year-old circular houses look even more medieval and mysterious. And that evening, there was a blessing of the pilgrims at the Church of Saint Benedict, the oldest church on the entire French road of the Camino. A young, handsome priest led a simple service. Several pilgrims read parts and prayers in their own languages. We heard Dutch and Italian and Spanish and French and Korean and English. At the end of the service, the priest invited all of us who were there up, maybe 100 of us, to gather on the chancel with him. And he said to us, "The Camino is an effort." Then he walked up to each one of us and he looked each one of us in the eye, and he handed us a small rock with a yellow arrow on it, and he said, "You will find your way." Or that's what we understood. And he hugged each and every one of us, and as tears streamed down our faces, we knew that it was true. The yellow arrow isn't just painted on the rocks along the way. Our lives have a direction. We can find and follow it. We can become who we are meant to be. We can offer ourselves to the world to help and to heal. So remember, you are on a pilgrimage. Set your intention. Let go of resentments and expectations, even let go of hope. Accept all the help and hospitality there is along the way and simply walk on. Walk on. Buen Camino, pilgrims.
Visiting with us online today. We love connecting with people all across the country and around the world, sharing our powerful message of love beyond belief.
There's something new happening here. You can now join All Souls as a virtual member. Our virtual membership is designed for friends who live outside of Tulsa, Oklahoma, and who want to engage with All Souls in a meaningful way.
You can be part of an expanding family, a global family, really, wherever you are. If you live in Oklahoma,
Ohio,
or Orange County, California,
Canada,
or Cameroon. By becoming a virtual member, you'll be able to deepen your connections with members and friends here in Tulsa and with members wherever you are.
Each week, you'll receive special All Souls content tailored for you, our virtual members. Virtual members have access to pastoral care, to personal prayers, and also receive invitations to exclusive web events.
You can learn more, and if you're ready, you can become a virtual member today by visiting allsoulschurch.org/virtual membership.
We're grateful our ministries are having a positive impact on your life, and we want to share the good news of love beyond belief with more and more people. So no matter what, we need your support to keep this ministry growing and thriving, so please consider making a gift today. You can do so by texting
LOVEBB for Love Beyond Belief to 73256, or simply visit our website. You are a blessing in our lives. May you be blessed.
And be a blessing.